Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining. I'm Rahul. Rahul Agarwal, part of American Express, Credit and Fraud Risk. So I'm sure all of you must have gone through a very heavy dose of machine learning, data science, a lot of code algorithms. So I promise this is going to be a very light session. You're not going to see any piece of code or anything very heavy on your head. And I'm going to keep it, in a way that there will be a lot of stories around what we are doing. So we started this journey of, data quality long time back. But there were a lot of challenges we faced in the journey. And this story is all about how we solve for those challenges and what worked for us, what didn't work for us. So I'll just talk about that. So I'll start with one of a interesting story. There was three British researchers, who were, looking at ozone layer across the world, that how this is performing. And they realized in 1985 that there is a big depletion in ozone on Antarctic. Almost 90% depletion was there. And they were surprised that there is actually a, there is actually a satellite, Nimbus 7, which was monitoring this entire ozone on Antarctic. But why Nimbus 7 was not able to capture it? And when they looked through the data, they realized actually Nimbus 7 was able to capture the problem 7 years before. But the data was considered by software as anomaly because values were too low. So it was completely ignored and the problem remained undetected for like 7 years. So that's just a start point for, how anomalies can make a difference to your results. And I'm going to just show some of the quotes I took from internet. The average financial impact of poor data quality on organization is almost $15 million per year. That's by Gartner. And then bad data cost $3.1 trillion per year. So these are some big numbers. I mean, again, every company, every organization has some impact of poor data quality. So now, coming to American Express, why this is so important to us? So if you see American Express, we are a truly global company, with presence in 134 countries with 59,000 employees. And if you see our build business, it's around $1.2 trillion. And just to give a context or size of the business, if you look at the size of Indian economy, we are at around $2.6 trillion in terms of GDP. So we are close to 45% of that Indian economy in terms of our build business. So that's the size and numbers we deal in. Now, why it is so important to us? So on a daily basis, we are making decisions on billions of dollars in build business. We are touching millions of customers every day. And we are processing thousands of new accounts application who are applying for our card and products. Now, let me just give you some interesting scenarios from the past. So when you visit a merchant, you swipe your card, what is your expectations? The expectations are that within a second or two, you will get a decision and most likely that will be an approval and you are done. But what you don't observe is that behind every such decision, we have close to 10,000 variables, 4,000 plus rules, which are playing a role behind every such decisions. And a couple of years back, we have an interesting scenario. Then there was a new variable which was introduced to one of our models. And there was some initialization problem with the variable. Now see what happened. All of a sudden, our decline rates went up from 0.5% to 12%. And that train remained for 4 hours, 5 hours. It's not only a financial loss or impact to us, but more than that, it's a branding impact, which was very huge. Coming to the, not only this is not an issue only with internal data, I'll take another scenario with the external data. So we deal in a lot with the data coming from third party, bureaus for our new accounts acquisition or approval processes. So what happened some time back, one of the bureaus changed the bureau score version of that data, which we didn't update it in our system. We are expecting data to behave in a certain fashion, but with the new scoring altogether, the models were not accustomed to that particular variable, and we start consuming it in the same way the way we were consuming the old score. And we can see an immediate change in our results and outcome, you know, from the acquisition standpoint. So these are some of the examples how these change in behavior in data impacts us. So overall, if you see, the margin for error is very small. Now coming to the problem, that why this problem is a very complex problem to solve for, you know. So if we see, you know, what is anomaly detection? It is nothing but you are trying to define boundaries around your data, and anything outside the boundary, you are calling it an anomaly, and anything within the boundary is the pure data. Now the challenge is where to define the boundary, because there is no right or wrong answer to say, hey, this is the right way to define the boundary and this is the wrong way to define it. And if you define it too tight, you may end up getting a lot of noise, a lot of, you know, alerts. If you try to make it too relaxed, you may lose out the real problem and real issue. So I'll exemplify it with one of the interesting, you know, very interesting example. So, you know, when I was, you know, young, I used to play, you know, love playing the video games. And, you know, there was one of the most favorite one for me was the, you know, the Mario. And within that, there was, you know, Nintendo was a creature for creator for the Mario. And this person again created the another interesting series in 90s called Finding Waldo. Now, Waldo is an interesting character, you know, with red and white sweater and red and white, you know, hat. And he wants to be an astronaut. He wants to go to the moon. And by figuring him out in the images, we can get more points to take him to the moon. So we are helping him out. So let's look at this picture. How many of you can see the Waldo in this picture? I can start seeing some hands. 5, 6, 7. Still quite a many. Let me change the complexity of the problem. Now, how many of you can find the world over here? So it's difficult. Now look at what has changed between these two you know, images. First of all, the number of characters in this image are way too high than what they were earlier. So that's what exactly is happening with data. What we used to have data 10 years, 15 years back, we are dealing with a smaller amount of data. Now we are dealing with a huge amount of data. So data has gone multifold. The second is there are a lot of similar looking patterns with red and whites. So what we call this is the noise in data. There is so much noise in data, it's very difficult to identify which is the real Waldo versus which is the something red and white. So that's the another problem we are seeing. The third problem is the time to market. If you see, if you can definitely detect the Waldo in this picture, but you will take a huge amount of time in figuring out where is the Waldo. And that's where the time to market has gone up for all these reasons. So if I summarize these challenges, what we are facing, you know, we are having a lot of high false positive in the data. We have lack of scalability, very high time to market, low adaptability, and a lot of inconclusive alerts. So that's the problem statement which we are facing. And let me just talk about the approach, how we were solving for it. So our original approach, which we are using a couple of years back, we were using multiple statistical functions, you know, which were just generally industry standard, which was giving us a UCL and LCL. Basis on that, we are trying to detect the anomalies. Now, what was happening, I won't say this was not working, but what was happening, we were getting a lot of noise. We were getting a lot of high number of alerts. We have to tune every time series differently, because every time series had a different behavior, and it used to take a hell lot of time for us to just tune it. And there was a lot of inputs coming from our user base. Oh, can you change my time series to plus minus 3 sigma versus this and that? So it was a very big exercise for us at that point of time. And there was not normal distribution for every time series. That was another problem. So we started with that. Then we thought, you know, as a company, American Express, we are pioneer in machine learning. We started on this journey, you know, in 2013 itself by setting up an AI lab in Bangalore. And, you know, from 2014 itself, we start using the machine learning models into our fraud detection, servicing, customer acquisition. And today, if I see, this is the backbone of almost every decision happening in American Express. So we thought, why not we try to leverage it for data anomaly detection and see, you know, how this can help us in this entire journey. So this was our first novel approach, what we tried. We took, different type of model, and then we try an ensemble approach. So in ensemble, what we realize is that, every type of model is solving for one given type of problem. And based on that, we are looking at, where is the majority vote coming? If majority is saying this is an anomaly, then we are considering it as an anomaly. If majority is saying it's not an anomaly, we are not taking it as an anomaly. So with this approach, we were able to take care of a lot of seasonality, trends, and a lot of such behaviors which we were getting earlier. So noise went down quite dramatically. And if we see some of the results which we are able to generate out of it, our accuracy went up by almost 50%, which was a huge jump, in terms of, in another word, we are able to cut down our false positive by 50%. Time to market, almost 3x gain over in time to market. And why is it so? We don't require to take any inputs from user. We don't require to tune the, the limits taken from the users. But still, there were some tuning we have to do for each of these different models which we are trying over there. The execution speed was very nice because we got a new big data cluster, very powerful cluster, and we were able to run all these models over there. So time to execution was very, very fast. And the detection time went down just because the number of, now the user needs to look at less number of alerts in place of what they were getting earlier. So our detection time really went down. But then we realized what next can we do on top of it. And that's where we went to the, revised ensemble approach, which was a weighted ensemble. Now here, what we were doing, we are putting all these different type of models on historical time series. And based on that, we were saying, which model is better suited for that given time series versus which is not. And based on that, we were defining a weight for that particular model. The another interesting thing we also did is we also had another algorithm to quantify the anomaly in terms of a score. So what we are also looking at that if there was an anomaly, then how you quantify it? Is it a small anomaly? You can give it a weightage of 20 points versus a bigger anomaly, which is a weightage of 80 points. So now in terms of your historical time series, when the model is running on that, what type of anomalies it is able to detect? The smaller value time series anomalies or the high time, the large time anomalies? So that was another interesting learning which we had in the journey. So with the revised ensemble, if you look at the results, the accuracy went to 80% now. We went up by 80% in accuracy. So almost now every other alert was very, very relevant for us. The kind of alerts we were getting were now very, very relevant. The time to market really went down because there was no user input of any sort. All you were giving us was that, we have a time series. We know we have to just monitor it, put it to the learning techniques, and then within models will get tuned on their own, and then we can just apply this entire mechanism right away. So almost you give us something to us, next day it's up and running. So that's the kind of benefit we got in the time to market. Execution was again good, and detection time went again, quite low by 70% now. So that was the other benefit out of it. And within detection time, one more thing as we did was that we are further giving the scoring for every alert to people. So they know exactly if they have limited amount of time, which one is a bigger anomaly versus a smaller anomaly, and they can pay more weightage to that particular feature, or that particular alert. So I'll just come to some of the key learnings, which we had in this entire journey, The first thing was supervised versus unsupervised. We thought initially when we started that can we go with the supervised, I'll take questions towards the end. So can we go with the supervised, model, learning model over here. But what we realize is that number of data points we have from the historical learning is very, very low. There are, because it's not like, you are getting in a time series, you're getting 50 alerts every, there are 50 issues happening in reality. There is hardly one or two issue which has happened in last 2 years or 1 year. And for you to know that issue exactly and then based on that, can you train your model? It was very difficult. So we went with the unsupervised and what we are doing is now every alert which we are generating, we are taking a user feedback on that. That is it a relevant alert or not? If they say it's a relevant alert, we are feeding it back to the system. So that's the one thing which we are doing. The other part was explainability. So, what we realize is that you can definitely generate a lot of alerts, but can you really explain it to a user that what is the problem here? So until you have a good explainability for a given behavior coming out of machine, it is of no sense or no use for people. So you have to relate it to the actual business problem and more contextualization around it that why this is happening. We are also exploring, some of the tools and utility which can provide us the explainability more in a grammar, English grammar type of thing, where we can have all this as a verbiage rather than user needs to define their own thinking that what is happening over here. But that is very important, the explainability of the entire thing. Multivariate versus univariate. So we started with univariate, and that's working absolutely fine for us. One of the things which what we learned about is that a lot of times, suppose we are getting bureau data. Now there are 15 variables coming from bureau, and all of a sudden, one fine day, their missing percentage went from 0.1% to 12.372%. So now I can correlate that these 15 variables are behaving similar in a similar fashion, because there is a correlation in terms of their missing percentage, because it can't be a random thing that all of a sudden my 15 variables have a same missing percentage to that precision. So we are able to correlate all these alerts together, and basis on that we were able to further reduce our number of alerts, because now I know if a lot of time what used to happen, if there is a problem, it will create problem for almost 40 or 50 variables in one shot. But by correlating that, the percentage of deviation, we can easily correlate those variables. And based on that, we can reduce the total number of alerts. Talent in-house versus external. This was another interesting thing. So for us, the good part was that we have a lot of strong in-house talent on machine learning. There was a good practice of machine learning, in different part of the organization. So we were able to leverage that. I would also say we were having some citizen data scientists on our side, plus we got some external talent from market. So by combining all these things, we were able to take it forward. But if we just purely think of, can we do it purely with the in-house talent, it becomes difficult unless they have that level of skill set or, and bringing some external perspective, also speed up the overall journey. The other part was the play small bets and fail fast. This was very interesting, because we never know what is going to work, what is not going to work in this journey. So we tried many, many things. What I have shown is just few examples to you, but we have gone through a series of things which we tried in this journey. Some of them really work well, some of them didn't work well. But we were never stuck to a given point. We were always, experimenting. So that worked very well. We have failed many, many times in this journey, but the cost of failure was very low for us. So I'll just conclude that, we are able to find our Waldo in some form and shape. I'm sure this is going to be a journey for all of you as well. So with that, I'm up for any questions you have. So, we are using a family of algorithms for each of these, models, if I come across. Right now, we are actually filing a patent on this. We're still under there. So, we can't disclose exactly which particular algorithms we were using. But I can give you an example, if you look at its statistical function, EWMA, it's a very good one, which is giving us good results. Or in terms of trends and seasonality, double exponential, that's also working well for us. Or hypothesis, something like Grubbs test, that's giving us good insight in terms of the hypothesis test that, is it working well or not. So some of these things we are trying, but these were just few examples I'm giving, but there were a series of models, which we are working through. And this is a constant journey, we are learning few things and applying few things every now and then and making constant changes. So I won't say that we have tried anything in exactly from the deep learning standpoint at this, but what we are doing is we are working on a crowdsourcing model within the company right now. So we are expecting some results in another month or two, and based on those results, I think we will be able to further improvise it. But at least at this point where we are with the current set of techniques which we are using, the results are really nice. I mean, any alert which comes, people just can't ignore it. And the good part is there is a scoring around it. So if you see a result with a scoring of 10 or 15, this is probably a marginal alert or, you can ignore it. But if anything coming like 50 or 60, exactly this is a problem. So basically we have got a, I would say it's a mix of things, we are looking at a lot of knowledge which is available on the net right now. We are going through, you know, what people are doing, you know, in conferences like ODSC, even what people are presenting and talking, we are listening. So whatever we can get from the external perspective, that's definitely very, very useful. Second, as I said, we have a very big in-house practice. So on the machine learning, so basis on that, again, we are getting some very good insight from that. And lastly, as I said, we are working on crowdsourcing. You know, already there is a project right now in the crowdsourcing within the organization itself. And we are awaiting some results probably in few weeks or so. Sorry, unfortunately, I've been asked to stop it now. No, I'm done. I'm already done. I was taking a few questions.
If you have questions, then you can take it offline outside. Hopefully, you'll be available.
Of course, of course. We are, and please visit, if you haven't got a chance, please visit the American Express stall over here and play some interesting games over there. Thank you so much.
Thanks,
thank you.